Coming up, interest groups contribute ideas to empower women in mitigating negative effects of climate change.
'23 close season for artisanal and inshore fishing ends, but for industrial trawlers remains closed until September 1st, 2023.
Centralized sewer system inaugurated at Ashaiman to manage wastewater and reduce incidents of open defecation.
West African Examination Council to serialize some selected questions in the 2023 WASI to curb examination malpractice.
37 military hospital hints of mass burial for unidentified and unclaimed bodies to decongest morgue on September 1, 2023.
And Nigeria cuts electricity supply to Niger after coup in line with sanctions decided by ECOWAS bloc.
Good evening. It is the second day of August 2023. Thank you so much for joining us on News On Live on GBC News and GTV. I am Winifred Efum.
My name is Sarah Fury Robert Rimpoman, so it's our sign language interpreter.
Now the news and details. Women are particularly susceptible to adverse effects of climate change, and it is important for their voices to be heard in all discussions and at all levels of Africa's governance structure, says President Akufo-Addo.
Addressing Africa Women and Children Conference in Accra, the president said when women are empowered through education, it has far-reaching consequences on food security and mitigating the negative effects of climate change.
Climate crisis, no respect of persons, impacting the lives of people in the northern and southern hemispheres of the world. However, there are regions in the world reeling under the pressure of climate change, with Africa being one of the hardest hit. Report by the UN indicate that one out of four people worldwide will live in areas with extremely limited water resources. Ethiopia and Kenya, two of the most drought-prone countries in the world, are likely to have children under the age of 5 malnourished if they are born during drought. And this brings into perspective the role of women in the climate discourse, and that is the focus of the Africa Women and Children Conference underway in Accra. The wife of the Vice President of Ghana, Mrs. Samira Bawumia, urged women to step forward and be heard on issues of climate change because they suffer the effect of the crisis.
This Women and Children's Conference is a powerful opportunity for us to unite, learn from each other, and craft a shared vision for a sustainable and equitable future. Together, we can make a difference.
The Deputy UN Secretary General, Madam Amina Mohammed, said amplifying the voice of women and children in the battle against climate change is the way to go, else expected outcomes can hardly be realized.
Africa suffers disproportionately from climate impacts, including floods, droughts, and food insecurity. Protecting the lives and livelihoods of women and children in Africa from these impacts must be a priority.
The Director General of World Trade Organization, Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, said including women and children in climate dialogues and decisions will ensure that policies are more representative, fair, and effective for people and the planet.
Trade can indeed, must be a part of the solution we're searching for. Though people often think that trade is part of the cause of the climate issues we face, the fact is that trade, leveraged appropriately, is also a powerful tool for climate mitigation and adaptation.
And to President Akufo-Addo, one of the ways to minimize the effect of climate change on women and children is by empowering them through education.
By recognizing and empowering women and children, we unlock the full potential of Africa's enterprise and innovation in tackling the climate practice. I would like to propose 6 concrete actions and policy interventions we must prioritize. The first, education and awareness. Educated women and educated children are better equipped to understand climate change impacts and adopt sustainable behaviors. Investing in education and awareness campaigns ensures a more informed and engaged populace, fostering collective action towards climate goals.
The recommendations from the Accra Women and Children Conference will feed into the upcoming Africa Climate Summit to be held in Nairobi, Kenya from 4th to 5th September 2023, with driving green growth and climate finance solutions for Africa and the world as the main agenda. Edward Nyakun reporting for GBC News.
This year's closed season for canoe or artisanal and inshore fishing has ended. The Ministry of Fisheries and Aquaculture Development performed the symbolic reopening of the country's territorial waters for fishing at Adina in the Ketu South municipality of the Volta region. However, industrial trawler fishing remains closed until September 1, 2023.
The seasonal closure of fishing in the country's territorial waters implemented by the Ministry of Fisheries and Aquaculture Development is observed between July 1 to August 1 for artisanal and inshore fishing and July 1 to September 1 for industrial trawler fishing. A report by the Fisheries Commission indicates that its monitoring activities detected higher fisher compliance with the closed season directive across the 187 fishing villages and 278 London beaches in the country. At the Adina London Beach in the Ketu South municipality of the Volta region, where the event was held, the fishers were busy mending their nets and fixing their canoes to resume their fishing expedition after a month's break. The Deputy Minister for Fisheries and Aquaculture Development, Mr. Moses Enim, commended fisher folks for their zeal to sustain their sector despite disruption in their economic activities and source of livelihood. He warned that the ministry, in collaboration with the various security agencies, will not spare fishers who use illegal methods in their activities when they are caught.
The ministry, in collaboration with enforcement agencies like the Ghana Navy and the Ghana Marine Police, would intensify monitoring and surveillance activities on our marine waters. The implementation of the ministerial directive on trawl gear selectivity will be continued to help reduce the catch of juvenile fish and address the issue of excessive bycatch and dumping.
USAID Ghana Mission Director, Madam Kimberly Rosen, reiterated the U.S. government's commitment to increasing food security in Ghana, including the availability of healthy and nutritious marine fish.
USAID commends the ministry for a number of bold actions that they designed to further conserve Ghana's fisheries resources. And these include, first, the recently gazetted Marine Fisheries Management Plan to institute a three-year moratorium on new vessels fishing in Ghana's waters.
A representative of the Ghana Immigration Service, ASI Justice Kudjo Numeshi, entreated the fisher folk in the country to desist from trespassing the territorial waters of Ghana's neighboring countries. He says such activities also promote human trafficking.
We are also encouraging the aspect of human and child trafficking, because traffickers always would want to look at the loopholes so that they can also do their activities. But when our fisher folks give them the opportunity, the chance to be able to transport themselves from our side to the other side and come back without hindrances, then traffickers will capitalize on that, transport people they are trafficking through these areas into the country where we don't have checking points to be able to get these people to rescue victims of trafficking and the act to be brought to a total control.
Representatives of major partners in the fishery sector, including municipal and district assemblies, industrial trawler associations, traditional authorities, among others, pledged their support towards building a robust fishing industry in the country. The observance of the closed season is in accordance with Section 84 of the Fisheries Act 2002, Act 625, which aims to help protect and replenish the fish stock.
The two-day meeting of regional experts of the establishment of the ECOWAS Road Transportation Information System has ended in Accra. They gave assurance that their validation will give credence to the implementation of the ECOWAS project. The ECOWAS Commission development partners and other interest groups participated.
In October of 2022, ECOWAS launched and started a road transport information system study to provide support for the planning and management of road infrastructure. It aims to improve regional and road corridors through the strengthening and implementation of a road information system, RIS, and the study is at its final stage. A 2021 review of the regional RIS will enable efficient monitoring, planning and management of road maintenance and others by allowing information sharing among member states. The chief director at Ghana's Roads Ministry, Dr. Abbas Awulu, participated in the meeting.
Information that will come along the corridor should be identified, and people, it should be uniform that the travelers should be able to identify with. Issues that come along the corridor, you shouldn't move from one side to the other. You are not sure what does this road sign, what does this road sign mean. So basically, the development of this road information systems is quite critical.
Chairperson of the meeting, Mr. Eberi Izunobi, an engineer, spoke with GBC News after the session opened.
For me, information is power. We all know that. So by the time you have all this data in one database, that means you don't need to go to country by country to get your information to do business in West Africa. You come to West Africa at one point under the ECOWAS supervision, you can get all the information you need and can decide to invest wherever you want in the African West African sub-region, which will make us more competitive in the world. This is actually a data source. It might not be physical, but is very instrumental to better planning for usage of the roads.
The admitting objective, amongst other things, is to validate the report of the current state of the ECOWAS corridor network.
Households in the Ashaiman Newtown and Bankuman communities in the Tema and Ashaiman municipalities have been connected to a centralized sewer network. This means wastewater from homes will wash through sewer lines to a treatment plant. In Accra on Wednesday, President Akufo-Addo inaugurated a system and said the project is in furtherance of his government's ambition to reduce open defecation to the barest minimum.
The Ashaiman Sewage Network project involves the construction of a new simplified sewage network for the Ashaiman Newtown community and the rehabilitation of an existing sewage network in the Tema Development Corporation TDC quarters. Approximately 4,800 households covering over 24,000 people stand to benefit from the project. The Bankuman Simplified Sewage Project involves the laying of new collector sewer lines, rehabilitation of existing trunk sewer lines, and the construction of new sewage treatment plant to connect people in the Bankuman community. Approximately 700 households have been connected to the treatment plant as of now. Both projects fall under the Greater Accra Metropolitan Assembly Sanitation and Water Project with sponsorship from the World Bank.
This is one way of ensuring the clean environment. And once the toilet facility comes in here and we treat, we're going to have an effluent that is safe for the environment.
For Greater Accra Regional Minister, Mr. Henry Korte, urbanization and stress on existing facilities has resulted in open defecation, which leaves no dignity or privacy, and this project is anticipated to correct this situation. The Minister for Sanitation and Water Resources, Madam Frida Prempeh, commended her predecessor, Madam Cecilia Dapa, for a timely and successful project.
I am happy to know that the new sewage treatment facilities would reduce the risk of these infections and enhance the living standards of beneficiary population in the Ashaiman and Bankuman communities.
President Akufo-Addo encouraged a rigorous maintenance regime to ensure sustainability.
It is expected that some 5.3 million people will benefit from these interventions when completed. Recognizing the huge resources required to provide, maintain, and sustain sanitation and water infrastructure across the country, government is in partnership with other key stakeholders and the private sector for support in providing these vital services.
The Shaiman treatment plant will be managed by contractors on site for the next 1 year before being handed over to the Gama Sanitation and Water Project.
The Institute for Democratic Governance, IDEC, has proposed reforms to help address marginalization and exclusion in the local governance system. The Institute says the youth must be at the center of decision-making through a constitutional amendment.
The Forum on Strategic Role of the Youth in Constitutional Amendment, among other issues, focused on the full participation of political parties in the local governance system. Rather than it being non-partisan, the Institute believes local governance is currently dysfunctional due to the marginalization of the youth in critical decision-making. A senior research fellow at IDEC, Professor Kwesi Jonah, bemoaned the marginalization of the youth in local governance, adding that the work of the assemblies will be enhanced if the ideas of the youth are taken into consideration.
The youth occupy such a strategic position in our society, and sports, politics, and so on and so forth, they are the ones who are doing all the voting. But in spite of this very significant position and role that the youth occupy in our society, there is also a certain gap. When we come to the table where critical decisions are made for our society, the youth are not there.
IDEC says the capacity of MMDCEs to effectively play their role as frontline agents of local development has in recent times been hampered by inadequate funds and delays in disbursement of District Assembly's Common Fund. Communities hardly feel the impact of local government and the constitutionally generated transfer of not less than 5% of total tax revenue into the DACF has not been achieved in recent years. The Institute says the actual transfers are always less than 3%. IDEC has for the past 3 to 4 years advocated for reforms in the local governance system to have the youth, women and chiefs at the center of decision making.
You are watching a major news package for the day here on GBC News and GTV. The West African Examinations Council, WAEC, says all depots for the storage of confidential materials have been inspected to ensure they meet the West Africa Examination Council's security requirements. At a media briefing in Accra on the conduct of this year's BECE, WASI, General and Advanced Business Certificate Examinations, the head of public affairs, Mr. John Kapi, says arrangements have been made with the Ghana Police Service to provide 24-hour security to the storage depots in the country. This, the council believes, will help prevent the leakage of examination papers and also ensure the smooth conduct of the exams.
The WASC for School Candidates 2023 commenced on Monday, 31st July 2023 with the Visual Arts Project WAEC. Total of 447,204 candidates, made up of 211,834 males and 235,370 females, drawn from 975 schools, have entered for the examination. The Basic Education Certificate Examination for School and Private Candidates 2023 will be administered from Monday 7th to Friday 11th August 2023 across the country. A total number of 600,714 candidates, comprising 300,323 males and 300,391 females from 18,993 participating schools, entered for the examination. The General and Advanced Business Certificate Examinations are scheduled to take place from 21st August to 19th September 2023. In compliance with the Council's security regulations, question papers have been printed and packed. The question papers will be sent to 45 depots in readiness for the examination. The Council has made reasonable adjustments to make its examinations more accessible to candidates with special educational needs. These include braille papers for the visually impaired, large print papers for candidates with low vision, additional time, that is 1.5 times the time allotted to other candidates for visually impaired and hearing impaired candidates, candidates with cerebral palsy, and candidates with autism spectrum disorder. Use of computers for candidates with cerebral palsy and candidates who are visually impaired but cannot read braille. Collaboration with the National Intelligence Bureau, NIB, and other security agencies to monitor the printing of question papers. Working closely with a number of security agencies to track and arrest dealers and operators of rogue websites. Serialization of the question papers for some subjects. Movement of question papers from strong rooms to depots in batches. Creation of additional depots for BEC and WAS for the storage of confidential material to ensure that the depots are located close to examination centers.
The Speaker of Parliament, Mr. Alban Bagbin, and some 8 members of Parliament have been honored by Mission Africa Incorporated for the outstanding fight against what they call immoral colonialism, to wit, LGBTQ+, illegal practitioner. Mr. Moses Fo-Amwini was also recognized for his role in anti-gay activities. Mission Africa Incorporated, in collaboration with local and international ecumenical council, were in Parliament on Tuesday to present the award, Good Fight of Faith, to 8 members of Parliament who sponsored the anti-LGBTQI bill, which is currently before the House. They are MP for Ningo Pram Pram, Mr. Sam George, MP for Whole West, Mr. Emmanuel Bezra, MP for Kwando, Ms. De La Soa, MP for Asin North, Mr. Johnny Tim Fojo, and MP for Tamale North, Mr. Alhassan Suhini. The rest are MP for Karachi West, Madam Helen Adwan Toso, MP for Ladade Kutupong, Madam Ritana Odule Soa, and MP for South Dai, Mr. Roxen Nelson Dapamekpo. A legal practitioner, Mr. Moses Fo-Amwini, who doubles as the Executive Secretary of the National Coalition for Proper Human Sexual Rights and Family Values, and an anti-gay rights campaigner, was also honored. The group then prayed for God's protection for all the recipients and all others who have joined the campaign.
Another fight we propose after this, let's fight to have a free technical and vocational schools in our country. We have enough resources to do that. And there should be free technical and vocational schools passed. A test that will bring income to create a skilled society for our youth.
The group later called on the Speaker of Parliament, Mr. Alban Bagbin, and honored him for spearheading the bill on the promotion of proper human sexual rights and Ghanaian family values. Mr. Bagbin was grateful for the award and said Parliament is not under any pressure concerning the anti-gay bill.
There was a petition from our partners, the Christian Council, the Muslim Council, on this matter. And so I had to now send a copy of the petition to the committee. Please, this is what they said. They have looked at your proposed amendment. They think that don't remove this. Let it continue. Because we are there to offer these facilities. We don't want government to take that cost. If there's any cost, we are prepared to take it. So they have to engage them and discuss. That is why the thing has, even though we have passed it in this meeting before we rise.
Mission Africa Incorporated is a non-profit organization based in California, USA, and Accra, Ghana.
The 37 military hospital has announced its decision to conduct a mass burial exercise for identified but unacclaimed as well as unidentified bodies at the hospital's morgue on September 1. In a statement issued by the Ghana Armed Forces on Wednesday, highlighted the need to address the issue as the accumulation of these bodies has caused congestion and hindered the efficiency of day-to-day operations at the facility.
According to the statement, the last mass burial exercise was conducted on 11th March 2017. The Ghana Armed Forces encouraged relatives of the unclaimed bodies to visit the Department of Anatomical Pathology of the 37 Military Hospital from Thursday, August 3rd to Thursday, 31st August 2023 to claim the bodies. This is News Hour on GBC News and GTV. We are also streaming live on Facebook at Ghana Broadcasting Corporation. We have more stories. Don't go away. We take a breather.
Hello, good evening. Welcome to Business brought to you by MTN. MTN is everywhere you go. Now, GCB Bank is marking 7 decades of resilient banking with a desire of expanding presence beyond the shores of Ghana. In the years ahead, Ghana's most compliant bank, according to Moody's, will revisit its vision of becoming a pan-African bank with footprints not only in Africa, but in Europe. GCB will continue to explore technology to provide convenient offerings to its customers.
A Ghanaian bank built for Ghanaians and led by Ghanaians with a single purpose to economically and financially liberate local and individual businesses. What is now known as GCB PLC has metamorphosed from Bank of Gold Coast in 1953 to Ghana Commercial Bank in 1957. GCB Bank was born out of the recognition of the challenges encountered by indigenous businesses in accessing banking services from the existing colonial banks at the time. Speaking at the 70th anniversary launch of the bank, Managing Director Mr. Kofi Adomako said the bank has well embodied its vision.
We have supported state organizations like the Temaroa Refinery, the Electricity Company of Ghana, Volta River Authority, and the Ghana Water Company, and many more during times of economic uncertainty and growth. And GCB has shown great character and resilience. We have many times stepped up to the plate and intervened in the banking sector in many critical situations to help our economy plod along when it mattered.
First Deputy Governor of the Bank of Ghana, Dr. Opoku Afari, commended GCB Bank for the strides made over the past 7 decades.
Concerning safety, soundness and resilience, GCB Bank compares favorably with the banking industry's average, given its size and the level of financial intermediation. The bank's capital adequacy ratio stood at 17% as of May 2023, well above the regulatory prudential minimum of 10% and above the industry's average of 14.6%.
Minister of Finance, Mr. Ken Ofori-Atta, assured the bank of government's commitment to help the firm recapitalize in order to support Ghanaian businesses.
It is of little surprise that GCB Bank is rated Ghana's safest bank by Moody's, Fitch, and Standards and Poor's.
In the years ahead, GCB Bank will continue to invest in digitization, focus on the retail end of the market, with much attention on delivering value to its shareholders. And still in banking, the Bank of Ghana has attributed its recent loss of 60 billion cedis to the government's domestic debt exchange program and cocoa board loans. The loss, which was recorded in the institution's audited financial statement for 2022, indicates that Ghana's Apex Bank suffered losses on its holdings of government instruments.
The Bank of Ghana's audited financial statement for 2022 has revealed that as of December 31, 2022, the total liabilities of the central bank and its subsidiaries exceeded its total asset by 54.52 billion Ghana cedis. The central bank is now seeking measures to stabilize its financial position and ensure the safety of its operations moving forward. According to the central bank, the reason for the loss is primarily due to the domestic debt exchange program, which resulted in a loss of 48.1 billion cedis and some loans to cocoa board, which were impaired as a consequence of the restructuring program. This, according to the Bank of Ghana, led to the huge losses recorded in its balance sheet. The loss is a sharp contrast to the previous year, where the bank achieved a profit of 1.23 billion Ghana cedis in 2021.
BOG has holdings of marketable instruments. These instruments are instruments that BOG can go to the secondary market and trade for cash. BOG has these non-marketable instruments. The total stock of the non-marketable instrument was 64.5 billion. The haircut that we had was on the 64.5 billion. So the principal amount was slashed into half to 32. So that is actually what happened. Then the last item was the cocoa board. So the cocoa board, the non-marketables, and then the marketables. The marketables, the total in there, I think it was about 16 billion, which was exchanged for new instruments with new terms and new tenors and all those things. And then we had to put that back into the balance sheet. Then issues of fair valuation and things all come in. When you put all these three things together, it then puts us at that figure of 53 or so.
Some of the cocoa board debt has existed since 1999, because at some point cocoa board was struggling and we securitized their debt, and it's been on our balance sheet and we have been managing it. But then if you decide as a country that you have to restructure your debt, what we agreed with the advisors and the ministry is that we'll put together all government debt and also quasi-government, that is cocoa board. So that is how cocoa board also came into the picture, that it's good to put all of this together and account for it.
On the issue of retention of profit, the advisor of the Bank of Ghana, Mr. Steve Opata, said the investment portfolio of the central bank from external sources are growing and hopes to improve upon its books this year and beyond.
We have net foreign assets, which means our foreign assets are more than our foreign liabilities. And also, they are improving. If you look at the governor's MPC statement, we indicated to you that in the first, up to July, we built reserves of 1 billion. So that's quite significant.
Managers of the bank say, despite the challenges from the domestic debt exchange, the central bank is better placed to continue with its mandate.
When a central bank makes negative profits, or the central bank has negative equity, can it continue to discharge its mandate of inflation and maintaining financial stability? If you can, then you are policy solvent. Despite the negative equity, if you're able to do these things, you are policy solvent. It's been demonstrated elsewhere. Some central banks have had negative equity sitting on their books for a very long period of time, and they've been able to achieve very low and stable inflation. They've been able to provide the necessary liquidity to the commercial banks to ensure that the economy functions. So, will we be policy solvent in the face of all these things? And I think this is the message you need to carry out. And the answer is yes, we can do that. We will continue to fight inflation. We will continue to deploy the resources we have to ensure that the financial sector remains stable.
The Bank of Ghana is, however, optimistic that the government would provide capitalization to facilitate the central bank's recovery from the losses.
And still talking about the Ghanaian economy, the Ministry of Finance has been engaging parliamentary press corps, the Institute of Financial and Economic Journalists, IFEJ, and business journalists for a technical briefing on the media budget review.
The session, chaired by the Chief Director, Madam Eva Menz, was held to engage the media on the technical details of the media budget review.
This particular media had to reflect all the commitments that we had made. And so it's of particular interest to most people, not just Ghanaians, but also to the IMF, to the investors, and all of that. Another major thing that had occurred post the budget presentation in November was the DDEP.
It also provided updates on the improvements in Ghana's macroeconomic indicators, the nation's journey to debt sustainability, and progress towards the upcoming IMF review. Madam Eva Menz said the ministry was committed to consistently engage the media as strategic partners towards nation building. She also encouraged members of the media to give non-partisan reportage about the nation's economic progress.
That was business brought to you by MTN. MTN is everywhere you go.
Hello, good evening and welcome to the energy segment. My name is Dominic Noji. Energy analyst and CEO of Eureka Energy Solutions, Dr. Yusuf Sulemana, is commending government for the decision to focus on gas offtake issues as it engages in commercial negotiations with Talo for gas from Talo-operated oil fields. He said government should learn from mistakes in the past negotiations and ensure that the outcome is mutually beneficial to the oil companies and Ghana. Dr. Yusuf Sulemana spoke with Energy News.
Natural gas, which has been designated as a transition fuel, is key in Ghana's electricity generation mix. More than half of the power produced in the country is from thermal sources, and gas is now the main fuel for thermal power producers. The country is blessed with huge volumes of natural gas deposits. When petroleum was discovered in commercial quantities and production started, the partners were virtually offering gas to Ghana for free as per the terms of the contracts. Now the dynamics have changed and the country must pay for the gas from Talo and its partners. Negotiations are ongoing, and energy analyst and CEO of Eureka Energy Solutions, Dr. Yusuf Sulemana, says technocrats at the negotiation table must do their utmost in the interest of the country.
Our gas sufficiency, our ability to be sufficient with respect to our gas. I know negotiations are ongoing or is almost near completion with respect to our gas offtake issues for Talo, ENI, and then especially for Talo. This is the time that Talo is going to commercialize the gas to government of Ghana. We have to be able to negotiate well to get a very good deal and to ensure that we have sustainable gas supply, because gas is a key raw material for our power generation mix. And bear in mind, the thermal mix is huge and it's contributing so much to our generation mix. So and what powers the thermal mix is the gas. And so if we don't have a firm handle on our gas, we're going to have ourselves to blame.
Dr. Sulemana was concerned about the fact that nothing substantial was mentioned in the media budget on the unfolding thermal oil refinery TOR deal or partnership with the private sector and the way forward.
I thought something cogent could have cropped up for assurances of key players in the downstream that Thor is coming to stay, Thor is coming to be revitalized, and these are the players that we have gotten, and these are the serious measures that we have put in place. That was also missing, and it has always been the problem.
He said revival of the Tema Oil Refinery is paramount in the petroleum downstream sector, and the needed steps must be taken to prop it back on its feet.
Residents of Agotime Kubum and its environs near New Tafo in the Abuakor North Municipality of the Eastern Region have no access to electricity, though their houses have been wired and electricity poles and lines extended to the area under the Rural Electrification Project. Lack of a transformer to connect the communities to the national grid is denying the people the benefits of having power.
Agotime Krubum, a farming community, is about 2 kilometers away from New Tafo and has a population of about 300. The people in the community and its environs are predominantly cocoa farmers. They also produce cassava, plantain, banana, yam, vegetables, among others. Though the community is saddled with various challenges, the absence of electricity is their major hurdle. In an interview with GBC News, the community members stated that the Bwakwa North Municipal Chief Executive Alhaji Omar Bodinga and the MP for the constituency, Mrs. Gifty Chuma Ampofu, have captured it in their reports that they have provided the community with electricity, yet they have no access for years. The leader of the community is Mr. James Now.
Yankania, eh, dear, eh, hi, eh, like your seminal. Eh, hi, em, papa.
The lack of electricity in our community is a great concern for us. For about 7 years since the electric poles were erected and cables connected, we have not been connected onto the national grid. The contractor who worked on the project told us we should give him sheep, and we managed to give him a goat, but still we didn't get the light.
But still, we don't feel light in us.
The absence of electricity in the area is affecting socio-economic activities, especially the education of children.
Because of lack of electricity, our children go to school without ironing their uniforms.
We have to charge our phones in nearby communities. We beg the government to come to our aid.
The assemblyman for Tafo Nobi Beira electoral area, Mr. Emmanuel Na, explained that after the completion of the rural electrification project, the Energy Commission came to access the transformer to power it before it was discovered that the capacity of the transformer is higher than the capacity required for the area.
The Energy Commission came for examination so that they can power the whole thing. When they came, they realized that the workload is very small than the transformer, and the transformer is supposed to be 11 kV, but this one is it is 33 kV, which means that it needs a replacement.
Welcome to the health segment brought to you by Lufa from Tobinko. The National Health Insurance Authority, in partnership with the Korean Foundation for International Healthcare, has launched a knowledge sharing center at the University of Ghana Business School. The center is to, among other things, contribute to the best practices in healthcare financing and management.
The National Health Insurance Authority was established under the National Health Insurance Act to secure the implementation of a national health insurance policy that ensures access to basic health care services to all persons in the country. And to achieve this objective, the authority is mandated to implement, operate, and manage the National Health Insurance Scheme. The National Health Insurance Scheme was therefore established 20 years ago to ensure equity in healthcare coverage and access by the poor to healthcare services. As the authority marks 20 years of its existence, it has inaugurated a knowledge sharing center at the University of Ghana Business School to provide continuous professional development to managers of the authority.
We believe strongly that when you are heads at various places, become better persons and good at your job, those you are leading will also become good at their job. And so you are not here for yourself alone. You are here for the whole organization. And please take the opportunity to gather enough knowledge. And then I believe strongly that you will never regret that you did.
The center is so far training 45 managers of the authority to enhance their operations at the various NHIA offices. The chief executive of the NHIA, Dr. Bernard Okoboy, said the Knowledge Sharing Center is a testament of the authority's determination to continue learning.
The health news was brought to you by Kind Kesi Lufat from Tobinko.
Major cities in Niger are facing rolling blackouts following last week's coup in the West African country. The Niger's electricity company says the power shortages are as a result of Nigeria cutting supplies to its northern neighbor. The West African trading bloc, ECOWAS, has imposed sanctions on Niger over the coup, but has not said if these include electricity supplies. Meanwhile, Niger's land and air borders with five neighboring countries involving Algeria, Burkina Faso, Libya, Mali, and Chad have been reopened almost a week after they were closed in a coup that overthrew elected President Mohamed Bazoum. The reopening of the borders also comes just a few days before the end of the ultimatum to restore constitutional order demanded on Sunday by the Economic Community of West African States, ECOWAS. Cote d'Ivoire's nationalist former president, Henri Konan Bedie, who had not excluded the possibility of a return to power even in his latter days, has died aged 89. Mr. Bedie's sudden death was announced by his party on Tuesday in Abidjan. Crowds of people have begun to gather outside his residence in the capital. Mr. Bedie served as president from 1993 until 1999, when he was overthrown by the military in the country's first ever coup. Mr. Bedie's main influence on national politics had been to promote Ivorianness, the notion of a national identity and national economy in a country with dozens of ethnic groups. The nationalist policy discriminated against immigrants in favor of people with two Ivorian parents, affecting countless workers on the country's cocoa plantations. We have sports in a bit.
Good evening, Let's Talk Sports. I am Theophilus Sampa. The first standalone Africa Para Games will start from the 3rd of September this year. President of the Africa Paralympic Committee, Mr. Samson Dean, says there is variation in the hosting of the games. According to him, phase one will take place from the 3rd to the 12th of September this year, with the second phase fixed for the 14th to the 21st of April 2024. He has given clarity on the number of disciplines for the 2023 edition.
3rd to 12th of September. We are doing wheelchair basketball, wheelchair tennis, and the last being amputee football. Members are very satisfied. Although, you know, because of the financial implications and all that, but we are doing it. We are doing our best to get sponsors. We are doing our best to get enough support. We will do it. We have to fight the challenge and organize the event. It's very, very important. Because the facilities are not ready, especially with athletics, you know, the Legon Park is not ready. So the IPC has advised that we make variations in the sports for the African Para Games. And also, you know, there is a multi-sports center which is being constructed at Botema. IPC believes that such facilities with para powerlifting and its numbers and the kind of events that we want to organize, it should be at that center. And you are always aware that as at September, by September, those facilities would be ready. So we have sought an agreement with the IPC, where the board, that's the African Paralympic Board, and members have agreed that we will do a bit of a first phase of the event and a second phase of the event next year. So far, Africa has decided to choose that period between the 14th of April to the 21st of April 2024.
A free online learning platform that seeks to equip young footballers, especially girls, with tools to succeed beyond playing football has been launched at the British Council in Accra, dubbed Ubuntu Online Academy. The platform is geared towards life after football. A US-based charity organization, Soccer for Dreamers, has wrapped up their tour with the official launch of a free online learning platform, the Ubuntu Online Academy. Ubuntu is a South African saying which means I am because you are. The initiative, which is hoping to get more young female footballers to sign up, seeks to empower them with employable skills whilst playing football. The initiators of the platform, Soccer for Dreamers, led by its president, Mrs. Sylvia Akwaboah, and co-founders Baruch and Jed Akwaboah, said Ubuntu will create opportunities in diverse fields of endeavors and close the gap between the privileged and the poor. The president for Soccer for Dreamers, Mrs. Sylvia Akwaboah, threw some light on the online platform.
This is a two-pronged effort, to be fair, because we need to accommodate the youth, the educated youth, and then we also need to look at the semi-literate ones who are maybe looking for less official jobs. And so we're looking at, you know, things like hospitality. We need to get into a position where we are so customer focused as a continent. We're so well aware of how businesses run and how to better ourselves that it becomes a second nature to us. And that is where we need to get to.
The Vice President of the Ghana Football Association, Mr. Mark Adu, said this outfit will encourage all footballers on their database to sign up.
GFA, we have over 80,000 footballers across the country, I mean formally, but informally, we have over millions of Ghanaians playing football. So obviously there's a great market opportunity for them to leverage this for the boys and girls to be able to access and learn from it and also develop their basic skills.
A co-founder of the group, Jed Akwaboah, was happy they are helping to build a better society.
We realized that some of these footballers, they'll train in the morning and train at night, but in between those training sessions they wouldn't be doing anything. They wouldn't be going to school, they wouldn't be going to work. So we thought it'd be a great idea to come up with something for them to do in between, and Ubuntu can help set them up for life with interview skills so they're able to get a job, and other skills that will be useful to them in their life.
Soccer for Dreamers kicked off their charity project for the year 2023 with a trip to Chibi, where they donated menstrual cups and football gears, including boots, shin pads, jerseys, gloves, cones, among others, to 6 female clubs before making a similar donation to 4 boys clubs in Widiba. Here in Accra, they have assisted the skate soccer players with playing kits. Soccer for Dreamers team have promised a bigger donation campaign next season.
I'm here to relieve you of some stress with some art and entertainment news. My name is Heiga Owusu. Traditional dance in Africa is rooted in the hearts of the people. It enriches all of our social and ceremonial activities, which are closely connected with the traditional rhythms and music traditions of the various regions. Motswana Morongo is a cultural troupe in the swamp of Mount Modesa in Namibia. The group, which started with 2 people, now has membership of 200. Their mission is to bring the youth together and teach them about their culture and the history of their ancestors.
Motswana Morongo came into being on February 16, 2022. The group has performed to a host of audiences at most of the prestigious programs in Namibia. Their recent performance was at the just-ended 2nd Discovering Namibia Intra-Africa MSME and Township Economic Expo and Business Conference 2023, organized by the Africa Economic Leadership Council in Swakopmund, Modesa in Namibia. Their specialty is African dance, performing art deeply woven into the social fabric of Africa and generally involving aspects of music and theater as well as rhythmic bodily movement. The leader of Motswana Morongo group, Jenny Tebele, tells us more about the group.
Our name is Motswana Morongo, meaning the Tswanas of Erongo, which is a combination of Walvis Bay, Arandas and Swakopmund. The dances originated from South Africa, since the Tswanas are originally from South Africa, it's just that we moved to Botswana and some of them came this side.
The African society's dance serves a complex diversity of social purposes. She tells us the purpose for which each dance is performed.
We did Sitapa, which was Khomonyana. It's a Khomonyana, somebody's name, a lady who was sent to school and she went to go feel pregnant. So the father is crying, say, Khomonyana, tell me who impregnated you. The second one was Madume, which means greetings, greetings from us, Tswanas, greetings, Africa. One is we are dancing, we are rejoicing, it's a celebration song. I'm very proud and I guess I want to tell everybody there, don't forget where you come from because our roots are the ones which will take us far.
She said, creating the group has impacted greatly in the lives of the youth.
We've managed to bring all the Tswanas together. We've managed to win a festival last year, first place, which was held in Matutura. We started as 2 people, but today we are 200 in the group. Since in Erongo the Tswanas are so scattered and there is no Setswana cultural group, that's how we decided to come with this group.
Jenny Tebele says their dances can be performed at all ceremonies. They are calling for collaboration with African countries to display the rich culture of Africa.
We love you, Ghana. Motswana of Erongo would love to be in Ghana to partake in your cultural activities for exposure and to promote African cultures. For us, it's not a matter of just being here in Namibia. We are ready to explore the world.
So wherever we are needed, we will be there.
Within an indigenous dance tradition, each performance usually has a principal as well as a number of subsidiary purposes, which may express or reflect the communal values or social relationships of the people. Conclusively, Muchwanamu Erongo says traditional dances reflect their culture and subsequently serve as a symbol of their identity.
Africa. We love you, Ghana. We love you, Africa.
That's all for the arts and entertainment news.
And promoting our culture in Africa, that's all we have in this package. My name is Sarah Furi.
And I'm Winifred from Robert from Poman, so translated the news in sign language. I will be back with the late edition at 10 p.m. Thank you for watching, Newsa.